If anybody had ever told me I was going to be a comedian, I would have fought the person. But I realized that growing up, I'd always wanted to make people happy. Not really laugh, but happy. I started getting an inkling towards what I wanted to do when I was in primary three, when I took part in a stage production called The Gods Are Not to Blame by Ola Rotimi. I had so much fun on it, and I made up my mind I was going to study theater arts there and then. My people at home said, "Oh no, Maje." So it was a big war. Because I even passed JAMB, but because I picked theater arts, they forced me to go back to do A-levels. And I went for A-levels. After A-levels, something just told me, okay, then I went to see my friend, I went to, for my friend's matriculation in uni, like we were in secondary school together. And I saw a stage play called Jambitos, put together by Theatre 15. And I made up my mind, even if the heaven falls, I'm going to study theater arts in UNILAG. Unfortunately for me, there was no theater arts department in UNILAG, so the closest thing I had to the theater was the English. I studied English, went to school, joined Theater 15. I was on stage throughout. And whilst I was on campus, people would call me and ask. I did a lot of comic roles. I was Lakunle. I did a lot of comic roles, and people would now call me to say, "Oh, can you be MC at our hall dinner at our this?" And I would do it. All I got in those days was hugs and pecks for thank you. I didn't get paid, but you know, eventually, as thing went on, I became like the man on campus to handle events and all that. I graduated, and people I'd known in school would always call and say, "Please, I'm getting married. You want to be MC? I'll go there." They will pay me with handshake and a bowl of rice and something to drink. Until I ran into a friend of mine called, I started my children entertainment outfit. A friend invited me to their bank, back in the days, Metropolitan Bank, to provide music. And whilst I was doing music, Alibaba was the MC they got. And he told Alibaba, "This is our own Alibaba. This guy was funny on campus. This one." Alibaba said, "Oh, come and say one or two things now." So I spoke. I told a couple of jokes. And I said, "What do you do?" I said, "I work in a construction firm, and I have my gentleman outfit." He said, "Why don't you join us?" And I also, God forbid, I pushed it forward. If I had known, I would have pushed it to the back. A couple of months after, I came across Ake Akindele. I used to go to MITV in those days, and I'll tell him, "Tell me one joke, I'll tell you two." We used to throw jokes back and forth, and Fumi Farodoye then called me and said, "I'd like you to be a part of my program." I said, "No, wahala. What do you want me to do?" He said, "I'd like you to tell jokes." I said, "Jokes? No, I'm not a comedian." No. He said, "No, just come and say those things you say here on air." I started, people would call, "You are funny, well done, we like it." Until one day, somebody spoiled everything. "Hello?" I said, "Yeah, hi." "That's a nice one. Please, how much do you charge?" I said, "Money did this thing." Now I recollect hug and shake and this. That basically was the beginning of my comedy career. The next day, I decided that if I was going to do it, I had to do it well. I registered my outfit called Laughter Incorporated. I started being more professional. I moved with those I knew. TA, I'd auditioned TA in Theatre 15 when I was graduating. So, and he was on the scene then. I went to him, told him I wanted to start this. I'd go and do Boy Boy for TA when he has shows, and I'll go and help him put up posters and all that, so that I can put me on the show. He would send me out. And you know, a lot of people don't know this. TA basically was the instrument that God used to give me my very, very, very big break in the industry. He was supposed to do something in Port Harcourt, I think, for a multinational, and he sent me to do it. It was a Valentine's Day show. He sent me to do it. I met somebody called Goodman, who was in the agency then. The agency was Town Criers. And he said, "Wow, you are good. Where have you been?" You know what? come and keep seeing me. So I kept going to see him and say, don't worry. At a point, I said, well, this guy just making me waste petrol money. So one day he called me for something. They took me out of Lagos, and it happened to be Star Trek. It was the first Star Quest. Sorry, we went. I did the auditioning in. They gave me three venues. The MD of Nigerian Breweries came and said, "Wow, that's a good one. I'll see you in the other town." I said, "No, sir, this is my last one." He said, "What? No, you are doing everything." That's why I went all over Nigeria doing Star Quest. That was the year Casey Presh won, and that for me was how it all started. Suddenly, oh, it's about to go down. As a matter of principle, I don't discuss fees because I've had different experiences. Who even tells me I charge 1 million? Maybe it's 50,000 or 20,000 I charge. Who knows? I'm not too expensive and I'm not too cheap. I believe that it's not money that makes a person rich. Is the people around you, how you've told you, how you've benefited them. I've seen the effect of showing off affluence. I was attacked in my home some years ago. My guard was killed, my dogs were killed, and I made up my mind that I will never discuss money on air and all that. But I'm not too cheap. Nothing good comes cheap. And I'm not too expensive. You'll be surprised. Maybe you come and I'll charge you 5,000 naira. Okay, I won't joke about religion, because I realize that religion is very, very, very volatile. I won't joke about God. I can joke about God. I can turn a story in the Bible around, like the story of Lot. I can talk about the fast being inconclusive. But I will not joke with the name of God. I won't joke with other people's religion or my religion, because I know when it comes to religion, people are very sensitive. If they think I won't joke about politics, they lie. I will. Because they are human beings. What else would I joke about? I won't joke with, and you see, with old age comes a lot of responsibilities. I won't tell raw jokes at events. I will never, because I have kids and they now hear me say, "They oh man, Condi," and I say, "Daddy, you're a useless man." Then what else won't I do? Sensitive national issues like Boko Haram, like I won't joke with them. I won't abuse people. I did a joke once. I just said something in passing about what's the name of this network? And the network that the MD jumped from the ceiling or jumped from his office. I didn't know he had died. I didn't know anything had happened to him. I heard something about the network that's always jumping up and down. You never hear. And somebody came to me and said, "You know, the man just died. Why would you say that? Why would you say that?" And I said, "Who died?" Said, "I think it was Mtel or something. I don't remember." Said the guy, I said, "But I didn't know. I just..." Eventually, the man and I are very good friends now. There's no way you will talk that you won't offend people. But once your mind is clean, but then there's no way you say something that... But I've never been slapped for saying something, sure. It depends on what they want me to do. And I worked in the villa twice when the former president just came in. But subsequently, I picked sides. It affected me because they didn't give me a share of everything they were doing. I didn't get jobs. I didn't get patronage. But I felt that fighting the greater good is much more than what I could have gotten from them. And I thank God that I took a stand. If they had called me for an event. I would have gone and be professional. I did an event where the former president was supposed to commission. That was the Obajano plant of Dangote's launch. I was the one who anchored it. When it was time to introduce him, I introduced him officially and nicely, like I'm supposed to do. I'm a professional. The fact that I don't believe in what he's doing does not mean I can't work for him. But I won't go there and say, a man that is doing well, a man that is doing great things, when in my heart I know he's not doing great things. My opinion too, because for some people, he's still the best president Nigeria has ever had. But for me, I know that he was a very good man. Very good man. But Nigeria does not need good men. What Nigeria needs is a man with vision who is strong enough to move the country forward. If he's not good in the process, good. If he's bad, shikena. Even at a point with what I was doing with the other party, it would have been foolhardy and stupid to have got to want to work for them. But I also got overtures when campaign was going on. I just felt that it didn't make sense for me to support party A today and support party B. It's like drinking cola from one company and drinking cola from another company and advertising those colas at the same time. I felt it didn't make sense. For me, it's not, like I said, it's not always about money. If A is what your stand is, don't let them find you doing B. Maybe that's why I've not made a lot of money. Maybe that's why they didn't call me to share me that dollars that I could have put in my cap. Comedy is the biggest problem of Nigeria. Comedians are very useless people. Things that should make people carry gun, face Azurok and start spraying the gates. The next thing you go online, one fool will be making fun and creating jokes out of it. And Nigerians that are supposed to be angry will be like, ah, ha, they will be hashtagging themselves and tagging themselves. Come and see this. Oh, laugh, won't kill me, die. That's why there can't be revolution in Nigeria. Comedians, they're your biggest problem.